truth and hope in a suffering society. The Signe de Vie Sida ministry that I have just described to you, a ministry to people living with HIV and AIDS, has common DNA with the Lausanne movement. Billy Graham came to Paris to the Palais Omnisports de Bercy in 1986, and his talks were beamed to various areas throughout France where local churches had rented satellite dishes and set up relay meetings to invite friends and acquaintances to hear the gospel preached. I was a post-conversion counselor at the Carpentras satellite relay in Provence in southern France, and I saw a number of people go forward to accept Christ as Savior in response to Billy Graham's call to salvation. At the same time, I read an article in Time magazine about a new virus in those days called HTLV-3 that mainly affected practicing homosexual men and drug addicts. And a virus that could stay hidden in the blood, remaining asymptomatic, and contaminate sexual partners without either person knowing about it until it was too late. So I put the two things together. I wondered how many homosexuals and drug addicts had gone forward in response to God's call through Billy Graham. Now, my main question was, how will I react when someone with this disease comes to my church? I believe in forgiveness, in redemption, and God's healing power in the different areas of our lives. But I don't think my theology is adequate to cope with this challenge. And I'm not sure that most of the Christians around me would know how to react either. So I wrote a story about this that was published in Swiss magazine Certitude in 1987. And sure enough, a lot of people wrote in, horrified that God would let such a thing happen, despite the magazine stating clearly that it was a work of fiction. And as for my own grappling with the issue, I prayed. You know, God sometimes reminds us of prayers over the years. I prayed, Lord, sort me out, my theology, my approach to this issue. And if I can be of use in this corner of your kingdom, then use me to address this question. So from the start, our thinking and action was informed by our understanding that as Christians, we all needed to grow some new muscle on our spiritual skeletons in terms of our doctrine of sin, forgiveness, redemption, and holiness, and what these things meant in daily, weekly church life. Whether straight or gay, HIV positive, HIV negative, we were all concerned by these issues. As we became more and more involved in journeying with people living with AIDS, and with the lesbian, gay, bi, and transsexual community, we never saw it as an issue or an ethical, as a social issue or as an ethical debate. For us, from the start, it was a question of the suffering of people we knew and loved. Several among us on the team had HIV. We were, from the start, co-suffering, co-sinners in a broken world, looking to God for him to fix us. We set out to achieve a very definite goal that is rooted in what we read this morning about Jesus addressing his listeners and opponents in John 8:43. You are unable to hear what I say. We knew that a lot of people living with AIDS could not hear the truth and hope in Jesus' words. Now, there are many reasons for this, including the root cause that they live in spiritual darkness and do not want light. But many of them did and do want light, and so we resolved that we needed to do everything we could in all the areas God opened for us to ensure that if they could not hear the hope and truth of Jesus, it would not be because we said it badly. So we spent our time looking for all the ways and means of speaking God's hope and truth in ways that could be heard by as many people as possible who are living with HIV and AIDS. And this included unwavering opposition to, as Christians, to homophobia in its real sense, in hospitals, workplaces, funeral homes, and in the church. I stress homophobia in its real sense. We understood that when the Lord Jesus asks his disciples to address suffering, it requires more than speaking the truth, getting the doctrine right, and saying the right things. It requires doing the truth as well, the truth that can be seen, as Chris put it earlier. Otherwise, it is not gospel truth, and it certainly cannot communicate anything of the hope that their suffering is looking for. And so this became our standpoint for 15 years of working alongside the wide variety of people living with HIV and AIDS in France. It was also the grounding of the message that many churches asked us to bring to their members, their pastors' meetings, and their youth groups. Among the many issues we had to address, two of them link explicitly to our theme this morning, truth and hope in a suffering society. We found that suffering makes hope difficult. Why is that? I think that it is because suffering foreshadows death. And as we were not originally made for death, we cannot get used to it. That's not Jonathan Hanley, that's C.S. Lewis. So when a disease like AIDS and a whole lot of other forms of suffering drops people into the grip of death, there is no hope possible unless we know that death is not the end. In The Mission of God, Chris Wright writes about the way the true gospel deals a death blow to death itself. He quotes another theologian, "The gospel is the power of God unto salvation because it promises to break open the vicious cycle of death. A Christology that is silent about the resurrection of Jesus from the dead is not worthy of the Christian name and should not be called a Christology at all." Chris Wright then goes on to add, "A missiology that omits the only ultimate answer to death from its range of responses to those in the grip of death has no claim to a Christian name either." That is the basis for our hope in the face of suffering. But suffering also makes truth difficult. Why is that? The main reason I can think of is that in modern day Europe and other regions of the world, I'm sure, there is usually a quick fix, untrue solution on offer. When we are suffering, we are usually more interested in relief than in the truth. And there is no end in modern society to the forms of superficial relief for suffering. It usually involves spending money and making someone else rich. And today, there are a million ways of avoiding the truth about the deepest forms of human suffering. So as we observe the European appetite for superficial quick fix personal development in the face of adversity, for the easy value of tolerance, which is usually little more than a cheap excuse for indifference, and for escapism in the face of suffering, we need to take up the challenge of bringing these three things together, the suffering that is there with the truth and hope of the gospel. We must learn how to respond to suffering without compromising the truth in our attempts to bring hope. Truth is the reason for our hope in the face of suffering. In reaching people living with LGBT orientations, one of the issues we had to grapple with was what importance we should give to speaking the truth from the Bible regarding sexuality. Now, if we are not clear on this issue, sex becomes such a major focal point that no hope will ever get across to those we speak to. As Christians, our ethics of sexuality, including homosexuality, must be secondary to our primary ethics of evangelism. I can see no other way of interpreting the approach Jesus took in his encounter with that beautiful, promiscuous woman on the edge of the well near Samaria. Jesus did not come to earth to die and be raised again in order to turn homosexuals into heterosexuals. He came to redeem unto himself men and women and children for eternity. Of all the homosexuals I have met who have come to Jesus, not one has ever said it was because of what Christians said about homosexuality. Always, it is what Christians said or what they read in Scripture about Jesus and how those Christians showed Jesus in the way they behaved. So, what is the situation today in Western Europe? Well, to be honest, the Lord has called me out of direct day-to-day work alongside people living with AIDS. I still keep in touch with a lot of the friends from those days and continue to correspond with Christians that I got to know when I was active with Senior de Visida, Christians who are wrestling with same-sex attraction. But the AIDS-HIV scene has changed in the Western world. I no longer feel that the same questions are being asked by the LGBT community or by the church. And as I said earlier, the Senior de Visida ministry has turned far more towards French-speaking Africa, mainly Congo-Brazzaville and Côte d'Ivoire. But also I feel that the window of opportunity in France has closed to an extent. The whole gay marriage issue has dug a trench, a ravine, between the gay community and most Christians. Whereas before, Catholics were the enemy, and as Protestants, we had a kind of positive balance in our favor among the gay community in many instances. This meant that by the time most of our gay friends found out what we believed regarding same-sex sexual relations, it was too late to call us homophobes, because we had already traveled a few miles down life's road together. We had drunk coffee together or wine. Maybe we had worked together or cried together. Maybe we had held hands around a dying loved one's bedside. Now, today, 2014, the gay marriage issue has put evangelical Protestants firmly in the enemy camp for the LGBT community. Now, I don't know what could have been done differently, and I stand before you this morning without the answers of what the church should have done or could have done, be it in France or in other countries, I'm sure. But I'm not afraid to say that it saddens me, particularly as the rhetoric used by fellow Christians has not always been compassionate in these matters. I am convinced that we needed to say something about the same-sex marriage, about same-sex marriage and adoption. But I have to say, I have sat down with AIDS, with the AIDS support group, and I remember talking with a bunch of gay guys about what it meant to them to not have babies and to not be able to be dads. For some of them, never. And I know that beyond the posturing and the politics, this issue is one of suffering. But maybe it was time for that door to close as history unfolds into the different future that Chris mentioned this morning. In my group this morning, Manfred said he would like to hear more practical challenges after after the talks. So here are the four questions that I raise in reaction to some of these issues I've been talking about. Four questions that I raise in my multiplex presentation this afternoon. Why do we say homosexuality and alternative sexualities are sin? Because the Bible says so is in no way a sufficient answer if we want to reach the LGBT community. Second question, how can we avoid falling into the extremes of either graceless condemnation on the one hand or wrongful acceptance on the other? Third question, now that gay marriage is a reality in several European countries, what should an appropriate pastoral response look like? By appropriate, I mean a response that keeps pointing people to Jesus. And as we dialogue about LGBT issues among leaders, pastoral carers, theologians, how can we comply with the priority that Jesus gave to unity, love, respect for each other when we, for instance, come to different conclusions as to how to behave and what to say in these very complex ethical matters? Jesus met a lot of suffering people in the 33 or so years he walked the earth. And we can read the accounts of many of those encounters in the four Gospels. One of the most striking of those encounters for me has always been the walking Bible study that Jesus had with those two disciples on the road to Emmaus, specifically because of their hopelessness. Without going too far in my interpretation of Luke 24, I believe that their suffering, the suffering of those two disciples, included several compounding factors, such as shame, anger, and grief. We are told that when they saw his hands breaking bread, their eyes were open. Did they suddenly see the nail marks that had been hidden by his sleeves until that moment? Maybe. There is no better lesson from Scripture than this one, as we try to respond to the suffering and hopelessness of the modern day world, as disciples of Jesus, as Christians grounded in biblical truth. May God open our eyes to what those two disciples saw that day. The suffering of the pierced hands of Jesus, the truth of the resurrection, and the hope of his love for all, even for the shamed and the angry and the bereft.